sun's come up to greet us this morning, although it's still a quarter chilly wind when she's hanging around outside. So popping in the greenhouse for the first hour, and I've got some international kidney potatoes I'm going to try in a couple of buckets, and I'll just show you them now.
Zite tubers, and I'll be planting 4 to a 30 litre bucket each, using a similar mix to last time, definitely without the water retaining gel. These have chitted to this stage in round about 3 weeks, so I guess I'm ready to go in the pots now. I won't bother filming the pots because you've seen it all before and it gets a bit boring. I'll just do it and I'll show you when the pots have finished. And there we have it. There's 2 pots done now with the usual brood mix, and I'll put them into the greenhouse and let them do their own thing. My mate has dropped me off some 6 foot by 2 foot double glazed units, and he's dropped 12 off altogether. I only need about 4 or 5, so I'm going to let the lads on the plot share them out with them as well. Nearly time to start thinking about sowing the parsnip seeds. The bed I'm going to do them in is down here. So what I plan to do first is warm the soil up as best as I can with a bit of either glass on top or perspex or whatever, and then we can get sowing. But first of all, I need to do a bit of housekeeping because it's full of stones. This is the bed it's going to be in, but as you can see, there's more than enough stones in there. So first of all, I'm going to spend an hour or two with the plank across the top and start picking the stones out. This bed's had no manure in at all for this year, so it'd be ideal for the parsnips. I did say our site was quite posh. In fact, we had a royal visitor over the weekend, but I was away at the royal, at the Edible Garden Show. There's a few remains still left over the visit, I'll just show you. And there you can see the red carpet where Her Majesty did a bit of digging for us. It was an early start for me this morning. I was up at 4:30 to watch the Australian Grand Prix live, and so I think it's going to be a bit tiring today. Now I'll just check you for a quick walk and just show you what's happening inside the greenhouse and the allotment. So look along the top here, is the marigolds are up now well. And also the broad beans are just starting to poke the reds up. Nothing showing off them red onion sets yet, but I've since some heat treated ones. One after I've seen Dan planting his head, them look pretty good, so I've ordered some of those. These are the mixed sweet peas, they were just starting to pop up. Some red one sets there, just I had one or two coming up, and again more sweet peas poking up. These are the sunflowers. We've had a decent strike rate on there. There's 10 out of the 12 come up so far. And there's my shallots, Golden Gourmet. Master them, okay. I think I'll be putting them out probably the end of next week sometime. And the broad beans have just started to stretch their muscles. Moving up onto the top, we've got the the peas, and I'm doing really well. Them are the ones I soaked the early on wood, which is around there. So that's a very good strike rate on there, and I'm quite happy with those. These ones there, I planted these 5 days late, and I didn't soak these. And to me, the germination doesn't look quite. I know them 5 days longer, but that's why I believe in soaking the peas does help. This is a couple of trays of Charlotte's ready, just chitting now, and they'll be going out in the next week or two. There's some sprouts, Trafalgar, which need potting on. There's a couple of trays there of lettuce just starting to show. And the spring onions are coming up. The two down the back are both cabbages. There's golden acre there, which needs picking out and potting on. And also there's a greyhound. Couple more trays there of Elisa cabbage. And then the next one there is the cauliflower. That's Clapton F1. Both of those have been sown on the 14th and 15th of March. So no sign of those yet. This here is the autumn giant leeks, and I'm just starting to pop the reds up now, so I'll keep those warm and let them come on a bit more. The last few days, although it's been dry, we've had this biting wind which has been fairly uncomfortable out on the plot, so we ain't done a lot. However, I've managed to finish the end other bed, and I'll just show you now. And there we have it. I decided, I think I'm going to plant some onion sets of sensor, some heat-treated ones. So I decided I think I'll plant both these beds up with the onion sets for this year. I've had quite a lazy afternoon this afternoon, catching up on a lot of YouTube videos. They seem to be coming quite thick and fast now. One thing I noticed was the date I posted in my first video was exactly 12 months to the date today. So now I think I've got 42 episodes on. But most surprisingly was the number of subscribers I've got, which is 1,420, one-ish, two-ish. But that's totally amazing. I never in the world thought that had ever happened while I was doing these things. But I'm glad that people like it, and thank you very much for that. Anyway, must carry on. Some of you may have seen a few days ago, Tony O'Neill uploaded a video of a very worthy wild project for getting school children involved in gardening and growing. Well, it was while I was at the Edible Gardening Show, I was speaking to Mick Poultney, and I delved a bit deeper into what he'd been doing in the past. And he's put a lot of hard work in behind the scenes in the background to get the not only an area set up for the less able gardeners on his allotment, but a few hundred yards away from the allotment site there's a school where he set up a growing system on there with a tunnel and that for the kids. Initially that was for a grant, but as you'll see from the video, it's obviously an uphill battle because now Mick is partially funding some of that with some of the proceeds that he gets from his trading sheds which he runs on his own site. This is just the highlights of my visit, but I will be passing the full version over to Mick, and he'll probably load that up onto his site at a bit later date. So
it's a landing question. Morning, Mick.
All right, Rog. All right, mate.
Thanks for letting us come down the allotment again.
No problems.
You kept this a bit quiet about this thing you'd set up for the disabled and the kids.
You don't ask.
Is there any chance of showing us around and sharing it with all our fellow YouTubers? Right then, okay, let's go.
Right, originally, the fence you can see at the back here, that used to go straight across. That was our perimeter.
Right.
So behind was just rubble and fields and whatever.
And how long has this been set up?
I started this, it's got about six years ago. I just had a fad. My mate did it up Chesterfield. And I just wanted a challenge. I like a challenge now and then. I ain't got bloody time anymore. But it was basically to do two allotments. One for walking and one for a wheelchair.
Okay, let's go and have a closer look, shall we?
Right, I had to get some money, obviously, first of all, and most of it was lottery funding. I probably got about £3,000 off the council, but I'm strapped anyway. So, £29,000 I got altogether, and it took me just under 2 years. But it's a lot of hard work. I enjoyed doing it, but I wouldn't do it again because of the red tape.
What's that behind us, Mick, there?
What's what?
This behind this door.
This is a toilet block and locker room.
Okay.
But first thing I had to get done was get this doorway
widened
so I can get a wheelchair in.
Right.
This lot was tarmacked. That was another job. So I had to work our way up. I could have bought the sun with you.
And what was on this land there before you actually started the project?
Sod all, right there at the back, just derelict.
Let's just have a quick look over there. The other side of the picket fence, you say, yeah?
Yeah.
And how many beds are on there now?
Originally, I just wanted two full allotments with tunnels, raised beds, the lot. But the council, they ain't got a bloody clue. So I thought, right, sorry, I'll try it. So I asked for three times as much ground, because it basically asked for ground to extend our allotments.
Yeah.
And they show no interest. So I asked for three times a bigger ground than what I wanted, and they give it me. So then I knocked another four off our waiting list.
Right, okay.
Luckily. So the first one, which is this one, as you can see, the for wheelchair, and when they get up here, when they're in the wheelchair, I can reach the middle.
Okay, right.
So that can do it. So they got one, two, three, four. There's five raised beds outside. Fruit trees, benches. So when they come up, I mean, it tastes bad now. Or better when the sun's out. But they love it when they're up here.
And are all these, the beds occupied, are they?
Yeah. I've just started up again, as you can see.
Right, and I'll say you've teared the beds there and as well, up on the back.
Them are allotment holders, yeah. Them lot.
So them just normal plots on the back,
yeah. Yeah, but as you can see, people are learning about raised beds.
Yes.
So I'm getting them.
And how did you go on about filling the compost, the beds in here?
That was bloody hard. Mushroom compost, I mean, because I got the money, well, I got lottery money. It didn't matter, so most of it was screen soil, then well rotted or smuck, spent mushroom compost, spent ops, but they took some filling. But because of the length of these, we had to put a stretcher bar in the middle, stopping right. Bowing out.
Right. Are they normal joists, are they? Ceiling joists, are they?
Yeah, but them at the top, which I'll show you in a bit, they're even longer beds, and that was worse than these. But Each pot has got a tunnel as well.
So okay.
If I'm down here and it does start piddling down, I can go in the tunnel. The only thing is you'll have to have a purr through the net because they have padlocked it. But if it does rain, that can just leg it in here.
Okay.
So that grapevine I put in when I started, that was a corker last year. Bloody great laid off of that. It was ideal.
And again, it's
I'm doing well.
A nice raised bed. And do they share this central oil bed, do they, or what?
Yeah. This belongs to Alice House and Alice Home in Owen.
Okay.
People learn difficulties. In fact, I've got to put the water back on. It's bloody empty now because I'm empty. I've got to put the water back on. So I can either dip the water in canning or the wheel or the bucket.
Or they've got a tap on the bottom.
Or I can run out pipe. This one here is a Dudley Green team.
What's this?
This is the walking. People we walk in, they can walk.
Yeah.
But they've got learning difficulties.
Okay. And who looks after this? Then do they left to the own devices, or is there, have they got like a mentor or something?
Nah, what it is I think there's three of them. Three dogs that look after them, and they run the Dudley Green team.
And do they come down here set times or any time they like?
Any time they can get away with it.
Okay.
Because they work for the canal trust up Dudley. Like the old pump house is there.
Yeah.
They've given them, I think it's the second floor or third floor as their base. But they've got to do work for the canal.
Okay.
So that's picking up litter and crap on the canal.
Another grapevine in there. Have you put these ones in here as well?
Yeah. But when they're down here, they love it. Because they do their own thing, switch off from life, and they're getting a return from it.
Yeah.
Not like bloody litter picking. And it gets sort of all back. Yeah. Right, with these lot, I've got them two benches, a cherry tree, and down the side, there's fruit trees and all. Because the badgers were a pain in the arse, what I've had to do up the top and down the side here, which we can have a nose. I had to dig down a foot and a half, 2 foot in some places, and put metal sheets in, stop the bully badgers getting in. But it's worked, and also at the back end.
Okay.
But he still gets in somewhere else.
So how many people actually did the construction of the beds, building them?
Originally when we started, it was me and two blokes.
And you were just doing them like of a weekend or something?
Then one of them had a hip operation, the other one had his knee done, so that was knacking that up. So basically me and my odd mate. Susie helped us out, Jason, our kid Pete, Ben, Colin. There's a few on site, get us a couple of hours and that, but majority of it was me and my Todd.
So from actually starting this, clearing all the... to actually getting somebody planting something, what was the time scale on that?
2.5 years.
Well, really? Yeah. And there's still...
But wood chip this lot and all, keeps the weeds down, less work for them, less bloody hassle. Once they've got some money, then they can put another bed in, or whatever they want. They've got a bench, which is in there, that comes out on here. Obviously, it went in for the winter.
As you can gather from the noise, we're now at the local school where Mick's going to kindly take us round and show us the stuff he's set up for the school children.
The school itself, all it had before I started, was a shed here. And then that metal container, the green, and we'll see that in a minute on the way down. Then I got a grant and got this lot done. Because we've got no taps down here, we've got to catch all the water we can get off the roof. So I just, instead of felting it, I just put a black and white horticultural plastic on the roof. This is a bug's den.
That's nice, yeah.
For the little horrorvilles. It's showing a bit of wear and tear now. This was a Joster berry. Pain in the arse. Still waiting for the fruit. 53 years later. Rhubarb. That's always a good brew. I do with all the kids anyway when I get down here, bring a bag of sugar and a stick of rhubarb each. And there's never one kid that's ever had it off the ground. Well, we've lost two generations of gardeners. So the grandparents were gardeners,
yeah.
And the parents, and they ain't got a bloody clue. That's why we need gardening back on the...
I can remember having rhubarb and having the sugar in the bread paper.
Oh, yeah.
And what's these fruit trees you got?
Bloody all sorts in here.
Cherry tree.
Cherries. The gooseberries, black currants, raspberries round the back, runner beans, blackberry, black currants, 2 compost bins, there's a worm in here, another way to butt for the
way. We are now inside the polytunnel. It's one central rise bed, and I can see the kids have been busy. There's quite a few flower pots on. So what have you got them doing, Mick?
Kids Garden Club, Caslon Primary School, Tuesday afternoon, after school hours. Gardening should be on the school curriculum from September last year. Gardening and cooking.
Okay.
Cooking started, and well, half of it started, health and safety. Normal crap. But gardening ain't started anyway. Unless you got schools with money, or schools with people like myself who volunteer to do it. But I'm still fighting the local council, Dudley, and the government.
Do you get an allowance per year? Nothing at all?
Or we get off the... It's got to be after school hours, just not on the national curriculum. And we get a pound off each kid. But luckily I run the trading sheds, so they get chep rate anyway.
Right.
So it's got... I can hear Anna, fog on, leg on. That's who helps us. The waiter board was renewing the pipework in the streets. As you do, I go and ask them for offcuts. This is what they threw out, which are them lengths here. That's what goes in the hole.
Yeah.
It's not for the old stop cocks where you put the key.
Okay, yeah.
That's a tube going down. Ideal for growing parsnips.
Yeah, right.
So we tried this 2 years ago. Got the kids growing the snips in here. Three per pipe. And it worked. Because at the Morven Lake Show,
yep.
I started 2 years ago. Well, I'll be still bloody going. The kids, I got a kids' trunk competition for primary schools.
Okay, right.
And they can enter anything they grow on the school grounds, i.e. veg, any veg, flower or fruit. And they won last year with a trunk of veg.
What they got growing in this central bed now in the pots?
There's carrots in these. Carrots. It's hard to read the labels, I'll get them to write their own labels.
Yeah.
Sets them in a couple of starting out. But if they start in our little one, I've done a video last night and our kids are doing this. I start these off exactly the same at home.
Yeah.
Meaning 15 tray inserts, you can move them around the greenhouse, piece of piddle. Obviously, solid trays if you've got them. But if I'm in here, once they've shoot and ready to go out, there's less root disturbance when you get them out. If that was in a tray insert, you've got to thought about getting him out of that. Yep. You're going to split the tray insert. And if he goes soft or don't shoot, then you don't plant him out,
yep.
Meaning you ain't missed a gap. Shallots are bunged in and all. Spuds, they got their own spud each in here. They should have put labels in, but they don't. We've got a gardening up again tomorrow, so they do that tomorrow.
And how long are the A4?
What's that?
Every night for the gardening club? Hour and 10 minutes, right.
It takes somebody 10 minutes to get down here. Like when we've rounded them up. They've got all the clobber. But this tunnel, I'm probably 14, 15 here, I've been doing it now. So we've done well in the sense, you'll come up here at night and just show that the vandalism we've had at the back. The cover's done well. I'm trying to get a camera up, but everything boils down to money. And also they grow produce in the pots down the side and all.
Okay. Do they do any like runner beans or anything like that?
Yeah, everything outside. We're going to have a perv out there when they've legged it. Meat mould. I just made that for the kids. We usually top dress the big raised bed in there. And as you can see, mole hills are bloody everywhere. And the good thing about this, because there's loads of green ground on the school grounds, because the kids and that bloody hyper when they start off, I get them collecting molehills. When they come back, they're knackered, I can cope with them then. Saves you bearing.
And do you have the molehills for your plot?
Good soil. Best soil you can get. Best top soil.
So these are the rice beds, sir?
Yeah. Because we've just been down there. Abbey Road Allotments is only down there.
Just over the back
just there. Just over the back there. And I used to, because all my raised beds, 26 foot long, 4 foot wide. Each class from here had a raised bed, about okay. Three classes. Kids used to go down and grow what they wanted to grow, not what we told them. It's no good growing something they don't eat.
Yeah.
So they grow what they, and they looked after it then. Then Health and Safety, PC Brigade stopped them coming down. They got to wear bloody IVs, helmets, goggles, bloody flippers. Jesus. So I asked the head who was here then, and he wasn't going to turn me down. Because the school's got loads of ground. I said, can I do a full allotment on the school grounds? And yep. So I got $5,000 off the. You can have up to $5,000 from your local area accounts. This is ours, though, in area committee, that's it all. Because each borough gives so much each year. It's like for different projects. If the money don't go, it's bloody wasted. So I put in for the five grand, the lot.
And did you get it?
Yeah, they give me the tunnel, all raised beds, exactly the same as the disadvantaged kids down there. Shed, greenhouse, fruit trees, the bloody lot. So in here, they've got lots from last year, then we're going to come up. Garlic, that we need. That's a clean blend. So when them onion sets in there and ready to go out, they can go in there and listen. The netting, which is on the sprouts, obviously kids have pulled it off, so, or some is pulled off. So the pigeons have bloody feathered them, because we got SAS pigeons around here. I can get in anywhere. But it's nice. That can switch off down here. It's the only after school club that's got a waiting list, well, a big waiting list.
Nice.
They all want to get on.